Hi friends, today we are going to discuss Cambridge IGCSE Physics Paper 2, Multiple Choice for Extended Syllabus. The past paper code for this is 0625/22, so it's Paper 2, Region 2. It's taken from February-March 2022 past paper. The duration for this paper is 45 minutes. With 40 questions, so we have maximum one question, limit is 1 minute. So we have to answer in the answer sheet. Now, this is question one. If you would like to take a screenshot and save it in your laptop and then do this question for some time, you may do so. I will scroll all over this question and after that you can see the discussion together. So if you would like to take the screenshot, this is the time. This is question 1, question 2, question 3, here we go, question 4, question 5. Move on to questions 6 and then question 7. Question 8 and question 9 and 10 and question 11. Move on to question 12, 13, question 14, question 15, 16, 16, and question 17. Here we go, question 18 and followed by 19, 20 and 21, 22. Move on to question 23. Here we go, 24. Let's move to 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, and here we go, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 34, and 35, 35, and here we go, question 36 and 37, 38, and move on to question 39, and last question is 40. Question 1, the student investigates a pendulum. He measures the time for the pendulum to complete 20 oscillations. He repeats the experiment 3 more times. The readings are shown here. What is the average period of the pendulum? So the average will be 17.6 plus 19.8 plus 17.6 plus 18.6. We add up all and divide it by 4. If we count the calculator, we'll get 0.92. That will be the answer of that. So easy peasy. Question 2. A tennis ball falls from the upstairs window of a house. What can be said about the acceleration of the ball if air resistance is ignored? So there's no air resistance, it means it depends on gravity. So the acceleration, if there's no air resistance, it's not depend on the density, it's not on the mass, it increases. No, it is not increases as the value of G stays the same, the gravitational pull, so it stays the same as the ball falls because it is only affected by the G as air resistance is ignored. So question 2 is D. So the down acceleration is affected by the gravitational pull, which is always the same. So it stays the same. That's why the acceleration stays the same as the ball falls. Question 3. A car joins a road of a speed of 14 meters per second and accelerates of 4 meters per second square for 5 seconds. What is the final speed of the car? So in here we have the formula. Final velocity equals to initial velocity plus acceleration and times t. This is our formula. Now, initial velocity is 14, acceleration is 4, time is 5 seconds. So we just plug into the equation and we get 34. That will be our answer. For question 3, we have to remember this formula. So question 4, the gravitational field strength is 8.8 Newton per kilogram on Venus and 3.8 Newton per kilogram on Mars. An object has a weight of 42 Newton on Venus. What are the mass and weight of the object on Mars? So we have the formula. Weight is equal to mass times the gravitational field strength. So on Venus, an object has a weight of 42. And then the mass is question mark. The G is 8.8 here. So you can count the mass of that object. 42 divided by 8.8. It is 4.8. And what is the weight on Mars? So on Mars will be 4.8. So weight is mass times g. The g in Mars is 3.8 times 3.8. So we count with calculator. We will get 18. This will be our answer for question 4. Next question. Question 5. A student carries out an experiment to find the density of a rock. Which two measurements does the student need to make to determine the density of the rock? So density is mass over volume. So the student need to know the volume and also the increase in mass. So there's increase in mass here. 200 to 264, so increase in mass. So A and C will be correct. And then there's increase in the volume as the water level is increasing. Increase in the volume, so question 5 will be A. If you have any question related to all this discussion, you may write down in comment section. Type in comment section in Susan Hero YouTube channel. We will explain to you back with another video. Please do so. Question number 6. A car has a mass of 1,500 kilograms. A constant resultant force acts on the car and the car accelerates from 15 meters per second to 20 meters per second in 4 seconds. What is the magnitude of the resultant force acting on the car? So resultant force equals to mass times acceleration. Formula to remember. Now the mass is 1,500 times acceleration is, this is initial velocity, final velocity, and this is time. So acceleration is not given directly, but we know that acceleration is change in velocity over time. So you can get the A is from 15 to 20, the change is 5 over, time is 4 seconds. So 5 over 4 is the acceleration, equals to 1.25. And we always have to check the unit, meter per second, and second, it is the standard unit for acceleration. So 1500 times 1.25, then we will get 1900. If we can't read calculator, so the unit will be in Newton. One thing to remember before we plug in the number in the calculation, we have to always check the unit. Is it in a standard unit? If it's not, we have to convert unit to standard unit, so the calculation will be correct. Right, next we move on to question 7. A metal wire is loaded up to the limit of proportionality. Which statement is correct? So, up to that limit, it means not beyond the limit, the Hooke law is still obeyed. So this is null. When the load is increased beyond the limit, the diameter of the wire will increase. Actually, it's not this diameter. It's the length of the wire will increase. When the load is removed, the wire returns to original length. This will be correct because it's still up to the limit, not beyond the limit. Up to the limit of proportionality, there is no change in the shape of the wire. So number 7D is not correct. Our answer is 7C. Next question 8. The diagram shows a uniform meter rule, M and pivoted at its midpoint P. Two weights, W1 and W2, are hung either side of the pivot. The rule remains balanced. Which rule is correct? The direction of resultant moment about point M and direction of resultant force on the ruler. So resultant moment about point M, as the rule remains balanced, there is no resultant force acting on it, so it should be a zero. So we have to choose between C and D. And direction of resultant force on the ruler, on the rule, meter rule. So since this is still balanced, so it should be zero. So zero and zero. So our answer will be D. Number 8. Okay, the rule remains balanced. Question 9. Which physical quantity is a vector? Vectors mean it has magnitude and direction, so it's not mass, it's not temperature, density, it is velocity. Question 9 is B. Question 10, a resultant force of 500 Newton acts for 10 seconds on a car of mass 1000 kg. This causes the velocity of the car to double. What is the final velocity of the car? So we have to find final velocity, and sigma f is 500, and this is time given, and this is the mass, and the velocity is double. So we have the formula, sigma f is equals to m times a. We get the m, we get the sigma f, so we can count the acceleration, which is 500, and the unit is Newton and kilogram is standard, so over 1000, so it is half meter per second. Now back to the equation of acceleration is final velocity minus initial velocity over time. So it says that velocity of the car double, so 2 times of the final velocity, I replace with 2 times of the initial velocity and 2 v minus v become initial velocity over the time is 10 seconds and the acceleration is half, so we have half or 0.5 equals to initial velocity over 10. Thus we get initial velocity is 5 meters per second. So our number 10 will be, so the initial velocity is 5 meters per second, and what is the final? The final is double, so final is double. 2 times 5, it is 10. So our answer will be B for question 10. Let's move on to question 11. A child pushes a toy car along a horizontal surface and then releases it. As the car slows down, what is the main energy transfer? So a child pushes a car along horizontal surface, so the car has velocity, so it will still be, and then releases it as the car slow down. What is the main energy transfer? So the car slow down means it is still moving, it has kinetic, and then slow down to stop, so it has slow down by the friction, so it will be thermal energy. So it will be D for 11th and 12th. At time equals zero, a cannonball is stationary inside a cannon. The cannonball is then fired from the cannon. At time t, the cannonball moves forwards and the cannon moves backwards. What happens to the total kinetic energy and the total momentum of cannon and the cannonball between time zero and time t? So total kinetic energy of cannon and cannonball. So at time zero, cannonball is stationary inside the cannon, so there's no velocity, kinetic energy is zero. After then, the cannon is fired, that means the cannonball now moves. So from stationary, now it moves. So there is change in kinetic energy, A and B. We have to choose. Now, total momentum of cannon and cannonball. So, according to the law of momentum, it is preserved before and after the cannonball is fired. So, question 12 should be remains the same. According to the law of momentum. So, between time 0 and time t, the total momentum is the same. At first is zero because there's no velocity. The total momentum now, after it's fired, cannonball move forward, cannon move backward, so it is of opposite direction. Now it should sum up to also zero, so it remains the same. Question 12, and then B, it is now is question 13. If you have any question regarding this, we'll surely explain to you. Write in the comment section, we'll explain with another video why it remains the same. Alright, question 13. In a small hydroelectric power scheme, 800 kg of water drops through a vertical height of 2.2 meters every second. The electrical output is 10.6 kilowatt. What is the efficiency of the scheme? So if we count the power of this small electric hydroelectric power, 800 is the mass times the gravitational pull, 10 times 2.2 over the time is every second, it means it's 1. So how do we get this formula? The power is energy over time. Energy we use in here is from the potential energy because of the height over time. So potential energy is mass times g times the height over t. So that's how we got this formula and we plug in the number and we count the calculator, we'll get 17,600 watt. Now the output is 10.6. So how to count the efficiency is efficiency is 17. We have to convert this to kilowatt because this is kilowatt, so 17.6 kilowatt. So 17.6. Efficiency output is 10 points, so the output over the input times by 100%. If we count with calculator, we'll get around 60.2%. So our answer should be C. Question 13 is C. So 10.6 is the output over the input is from here. Output over the input, output over input times 100%. That's our answer. Now we move on to question 14. An object is at rest on a horizontal surface. Which equation is used to calculate the pressure that the object exerts? Now pressure, we have the pressure formula is force over area of contact. Now force in here is not the mass, but it's the same as the weight because it has the same unit, which is Newton. So 14 will be B. So that will be the correct answer. Number 15, small particles illuminated by a bright lamp are seen through a microscope. They move about randomly. What causes this motion? So they move about randomly. What causes this motion? It is because of collision, not evaporation, not warming, not attraction between a small particle, but it's collision between small particles and the molecules of air. So that would be 15B. Question 16. Ether is a liquid that evaporates easily at room temperature. The rate at which either ether evaporates can be increased by bubbling air through it. The diagram shows this process. Air bubbles, ether, and then this air. So student gave three suggestions why the rate of evaporation increases when air is bubbled through. Student 1 suggests that the temperature of the ether is decreased. Student 2 suggests that the surface area of the ether is increased. Student 3 suggests that evaporated molecules are removed at greater rate. So when air is bubbled, the evaporated molecule remove at greater rate for question 16. It is correct because the air will push the molecules at greater speed. And then so we have to choose 3 and 2 or 3 only or 3 and 1. Temperature of ether is decreased. That's not air is bubbled, so it's not decreasing the temperature of the ether. So 1 is wrong, 1 is wrong. So now is it 3 or 2? 3 and 2. Now let's see question. Student 2 suggests that the surface area of ether is increased when air is bubbles, bubbles will be all over the ether and it will increase the surface area of the ether. So that is the reason that the rate of evaporation increases when air is bubbled through. We have to choose C for question 16 is C. So this is correct. This is correct. Now question 17. Some ice is slowly heated and its temperature is measured. A graph is plotted of temperature against time. Now, which row describes what happens to the thermal energy and to the temperature in section X? Temperature in here is flatlined, it means it remains constant. So, and thermal energy in here is there is change in state from solid into liquid, so gained by ice, because the ice need to gain energy to convert its state from solid state to liquid state in here. So B. 17 will be B. Question 18. The diagram shows the apparatus needed for an experiment to determine the specific heat capacity of the material from which an object is made. This is the object. This is the heater connected to a circuit, and this is the thermometer to measure the increase in temperature. This is a stop clock and balance. Which piece of apparatus could be omitted if the purpose of the experiment is to determine the thermal capacity of the object? So, specific heat capacity, thermal capacity. So, we surely need thermometer and also measure the increase of the temperature. We need the ammeter to measure the current given and stop clock to measure the change in temperature in a certain time interval. But if we only measure the thermal capacity, we don't need the balance. We don't need the balance because it has no relationship or connection with the mass, because it's thermal capacity. Alright, let's move on to question 19. Both boiling and evaporation involve a change of state from liquid to gas. Which row gives the correct difference between boiling and evaporation? So, question 19. Boiling occurs, no bubbles are formed, wrong. Occurs at all temperatures, wrong. Boiling happens only at boiling point. Temperature falls is wrong. So, the correct answer will be C. 19 is C. It occurs through the liquid, and evaporation occurs only at the surface. Question 20, which statement describes thermal conduction in a metal by electron? So, atoms and electrons move freely throughout the metal. It's not so in the metal, its atom is fixed and only vibrate. Atom and electron vibrate, fixed position, no electron is there's mobile electrons that are free to move. Electrons move freely throughout the metal, it is correct. Electron remain unattached to the atom, not it is not so. So this is structures of metal, and electrons from the outer shells are mobile, free to move, and positively charged metal ions fixed in its place. So electrons are delocalized, they are free to move throughout the structures. That will be the explanation for describe the thermal conduction in metal by electron. Let's move to question 21. A tank contains water. Ripples are produced on the surface of water. Refraction is observed. What causes the ripples to refract? Refraction is the bending of the wave due to the change of speed. So the cold water replaced by doesn't have connection with temperature. Move from deep to shallow, the ripples, the speed change. Yes, we keep this one. The ripple hit the wall of the tank, is not ripple pass through a narrow gap. There will be diffraction, not refraction. So the Refraction is connected with the change is in speed. Question 20. What is B? This is a diagram to describe the refraction, the bending of the path of the wave from the deep water to shallow water. Here we see that wave transmit from deep to into shallow water. There is a bend in here in the direction of the wave. So from shallow water, the wavelength is bit smaller. There's change in wavelength. That's why it caused the change in the speed. And when the frequency is the same, so different speed, different wavelength, and different direction. Water is transmitted from deep water to shallow water. The speed in deep water is faster. The speed in shallow water is reduced due to the friction with the bottom of the container. So that will be the explanation for question 21. Question 22, the diagram shows wave fronts of water wave passing through a gap in a barrier. Which change will increase if the diffraction of the wave, which change will increase the diffraction of the wave as it passes through a gap? So how do we increase the diffraction? Will be increase the amplitude, it's not increase the width of the gap. No, it should be smaller, reduce the depth of water. It's not connected to that. 22 will be frequency of the wave. Yes, when we reduce the frequency, it means we increase the wavelength, and then we increase the wavelength, the diffraction will increase. This is the explanation of it. The important thing to know about diffraction is waves spread out when they go around the side of an obstacle or through a gap like this. The narrower the gap, the greater the wavelength. Okay, this is wider gap, this is narrower gap, so the greater the wavelength. The narrower the gap, the more diffraction here. So this gap is bigger, this gap is smaller. There is more diffraction in the narrow gap and the greater wavelength, so greater wavelength. This is small wavelength, can see, this is greater wavelength, see the distance, this is greater wavelength. Now greater wavelength will cause greater diffraction with given the same gap. A wide gap, small diffraction effect, narrow gap, large diffraction effect, large wavelength or small frequency, large diffraction. So what is the connection between frequency and wavelength? Higher frequency, I mean the wave is packed like this. Of course, we can see that it has shorter wavelength from here to here. It's a shorter wavelength from here to here. Compared to low frequency, it has greater wavelength for this one. It has low frequency, longer wavelength. If higher frequency, shorter wavelength. So I hope that will be clear for this question. Why reduce the frequency, increase the wavelength, and increase the diffraction? Now let's move on to question 23. The diagram shows a ray of light from an object O passing through a thin converging lens. The principal focuses in each diagram are labeled F. Which diagram are correct? So according to the main principle of the diagram of ray of light, the incident ray from here passing through the from the object passing through the center of the lens and proceeds straight. So this will be correct, and from parallel to the lens. So this one is parallel to the principal axis. It will be passing to the principal focus. Let's see the diagram here. Path 1 ray passing through the optical center, it will be proceed without bending. This one. Path 2 Is it the ray parallel to the principal axis will be refracted through the F the same? Is it the ray passed through the focal point refracted parallel to the lens? So this one is correct, this one is not correct because it has to go through here, so 2 is wrong. It has to pass through the F. This one passed through F is parallel, so 1 and 3 is correct. So our answer will be C for number 23. Next, we move on to question 24. The diagram shows a ray of light inside an optical fiber approaching X. This one. This is normal to the surface at X. This is tangent to the surface at X. This is P and Q. The light is totally refracted within the fiber. The refractive index is 1.39. Which condition ensures that the total internal reflection occurs? So it will be depending on the incident angle, which is Q. It should be greater than the critical angle. So it's not smaller than, it's not depending on P. So the only option is B, should be greater than 47. What is the proof? So critical angle is C. We have the formula, N is the refractive index equal to 1 over sine C. Now we want to know the critical angle, so the N is 1.39 over 1 over sine C. Now we can count sine C is 1 over 1.39, and when we count with calculator, we'll get 0.72. And C is the inverse of 0.72, and if we count, it will be around 46.00. So the only possible answer is greater than 47. That will be the explanation. Next, question 25. An eclipse of the sun happens when the moon comes between the earth and the sun. Which statement is correct? So when the moon block the sun, so the sun ray cannot reach the earth, infrared radiation from the sun disappears before visible light. No, we cannot see when there is eclipse of the sun, no visible light. UV disappears, yes, all disappears, visible light disappears, no, but all infrared, UV, visible, disappear at the same moment. So that will be question 25, D. Question 26. The diagram shows air particles in a sound wave. Which row identifies the position of compression and rarefaction? Compression is where the air particle is compact. Rarefaction is where the air particle at further distance. So compression at X, it should be correct because it's packed. Rarefaction at Y, so it should be correct. So 26 is actually A, not this one. V, the not V and Z is the same. Z, V, it's not. So it's A. This is because this is packed, the particle, this is denser, the distance between the particle. No, this is, I mean further. This is compact. So compact, it means X is compression. This is further distance, it means this is a rare fraction. So 26 is A, 27. Two isolated metal spheres are both negatively charged. The spheres are brought together close but do not touch. Which diagram shows the charge distribution? Of course, negative and negative will repel, so they will choose the furthest distance as possible. It will be D, but the distance is furthest. Question 28. Two separate circuits have different power supply. Both power supplies provide the same magnetic current. Power supply P has an electromotive force of 1.5 volt, and power supply Q has an EMAP of 3 volt. Which statement about Q are correct when compared with P? 1. Q supply twice the charge per unit time. Q supply twice the energy per unit time. Q supply twice the energy per unit time. Let's check. The only given data is P has a 1.5 volt, Q 3 volt. So P 1.5 volt, Q 3 volt. The same current, so I is the same. Now, Q is the power supply. So option one, if we talk about charge, it is Q, and then charge, and then time is T. So we have the formula Q equals to IT, where Q equals to IT, I is the current, T is the time. Q in here is the charge. So if the option A, Q supply twice the charge per unit time, since we is told that we have the same current and per unit time, the charge should be the same as it is the same current. So option A will be wrong. Option A one will be wrong. And thus we have D as the only possible answer now. But why, let's check why 2 and 3 is correct. Q supply twice energy per unit charge. Now what we have to check is power supply Q supply twice energy per unit charge. Now what is energy per unit charge? Energy per unit charge is V. V is for energy. V is the potential difference and Q is charge. So energy per unit charge is V is energy per unit charge. So this is the potential difference for Q is 3 volt, for power supply P is 1.5. So since the Q is double of this, the potential difference, of course, the E should be double for the power supply Q. So this should be 2E over Q. This only E over Q, since this is 2 times. So this option makes sense. Twice energy per unit charge. Option 3, Q supply twice energy per unit time. Twice energy per unit time. That is energy per unit time. So energy per unit time is E over T times, that is VI, V times the I, while the current is the same current, and the volt in here for Q is double. So it should be 2 times energy per unit time to supply 3 volt compared to 1 point volt. So if the P, energy per unit time, is this for 1 point volt, for Q it should be double, because it is from 1.5 to 3 volt is double times 2. So the energy per unit time will be 2E over T. So that's how this statement is correct. So 28 is D, now 29. The diagram shows a piece of metal resistant wire. Which wire made of the same metal has a smaller resistance? Small resistance means a larger diameter. So 29 will be A, because this is only larger, this is small, same, small, larger, same thing and larger, because larger diameter is give more space for the electron to flow, because electricity is flow of electrons. So large diameter free mole space for electrons to flow, it means smaller resistant. Question 30. Which label component in the circuit diagram shown control the brightness of lamp X? Lamp X is this one. So this is a variable resistor, so it will be V because it controls how much current will pass, and it will determine the brightness of lamp X. And this is here. This is a parallel 1, 2, 3 parallel circuit. So it is determined by V only. Question 31. A circuit includes a battery, two identical resistors, and 5 ammeters. P, Q, R, S, T. Which statement about the reading on ammeter is not correct? So if this is ammeter, so this will be here and here. It has to be the same P and Q. So if P is greater than Q is wrong. P has greater reading than R, P then R is yeah, because the current speed here, of course, this is correct. P is greater than R, and P is even greater than S because P is the source of current from the power supply from the battery. Now P is greater than T, it is correct because the current from P is greater to here. So the only wrong one is this one, because P has to be the same with Q, as Q is the total current that flow back to the battery. Yeah. Okay, question 31 is A. Question 32 now. An electrician set up a potential divider circuit in a fridge so that when the fridge door is open and light from the room enters the fridge, a warning light turns on. Which component does the electrician need to use in addition to variable resistors? So a warning light turns on when light from the room enters the fridge. So we need something that will depend on the light. So it will be light dependent resistor. 32 will be A. And the light dependent resistor, when there's light, the resistance will decrease and the light will turn on. Question 33. Two NAND gates are joined together as shown. Input 1 and 2. This is NAND gate. This is NAND gate. This is the output. Which single logic gate is equivalent to this combination? This is a digital logic gate symbol. NAND gate will be here. Input 00. NAND will be 1 because and this will be 1. If A1 and B0, it will be 1 in NAND, and 1 and 1 will be 0. So if you don't understand why this is so, you may write in the comment section. We will explain to you the basic of logic gates. Now there are two NAND gates in the question. This one and this one. So the result is put again in another NAND gate. So from here, the input is 1 1 1 1 1 1 and 0 0, and pass through a NAND gate. The product will be 1 1 will be 0 0 0 1. So this is the same as see, it will be the same as the result for AND gate. AND gate. You see, 001 is the result for AND gate. 001. So the answer should be AND gate. But that will be the answer. If you understand why this is so, I will explain to you. Write in the comment section in Susan Hira YouTube channel. Question 34. The diagram shows an electric drill and safety guards. The drill requires the logic circuit shown here. This is safety guard, drill, electric motor. Now, safety guard open 0, close 1, A and B. This is the logic gates, motor on 1, motor off 0, and alarm on 1, alarm off 2. Zero, the circuit must only allow the motor to start. So motor start is 1 when the safety guard is closed. If the safety guard is not closed, the starting, when the starting is on, than the alarm sound. So which logic gate is missing from the circuit this one? So to make the alarm on for question 34, the safety guard must be open. So safety guard must be open and the alarm should on when the switch is on. When the switch is on. So switch on is 1, safety guard open is 0. So it has to go to this should be 1 and this should be 0. Then this should be 1. So the correct logic gate should be, sorry, there is another gate that is a NOT gate. This is a NOT gate. NOT gate. So if this is 0, this will become 0, not 0 is 1. So 1 and 1 must be 1. So it should be the AND logic gate, because 1 and 1 will make 1. But if it's 1 and this is 0, then this should be, the alarm should be off. And when the switch is 0, switch is off. So even though the safety guard is open, it will still, the alarm will be off, so it should be AND gates. That will be our explanation. Next will be question 35. Two magnet placed near a current carrying coil. The diagram shows this experimental arrangement and the current direction in the coil. This is the current direction going here, so it will be like this. Now the according to the hand rule, it will be, the thumb will be pointing the north, so this is the north and this will be the south. So south and south will repel and north will repel. So question 35 will be B, both X and Y are repelled by the coil. So this is it. This will be a right hand grip rule and the direction of the current is this one. If we trace this current flow, it will be here, so the arrow will be down. So this is where our finger, the thumb is pointing the north. So in this case, this is also down, the thumb is pointing the north, so this is north. North and north will repel. So that is the idea of that. Question 36. Two circuits are shown as here. The iron rods are placed close together and are able to move. This iron rod is and this. What happened to the size of the gap at X when switch S is closed? This one. So we see, we trace the current is from here, here, then it will be here. So it will be, north will be here, the tongue. And this one, if we trace the current will be here, here, and it will be up. So the tongue will be pointing towards the left, so the north is here, because north and north it will repel, so it will be 36 will be C, because north and north repel, the gap will increase. This is again according to this rule, like this, and if the opposite current, like this one, is going up, so our thumb must be pointing that side, so the north must be in here. So that will be the explanation. Question 37. When a current carrying conductor is placed in a magnetic field, it experiences a force. Which statement will the force is correct? It is perpendicular. So it is perpendicular. We have the force on current carrying conductor. Left hand rule. This and this is perpendicular. The force is perpendicular. Like this, and to the field, and perpendicular to the current. Perpendicular to the current. This is perpendicular to the current, and perpendicular to the field. So it is all perpendicular according to the left hand rule. So it should be 37 will be B. 38 now. When a beam of alpha particles is incident on a thin metal foil, most of them follow a path represented by X. A small number of alpha path follow the path Y, which is reflected. Which row correctly describes a conclusion that can be drawn from each of these observations about the structures of atom? So, because it passed through, it means atom is mostly empty space. Will be A and B, mean nothing attract or reflect it. And path Y, this is to explain path X. Path Y is it reflected, means something repels alpha particles. Nucleus contain proton and neutron, not so with hydrogen. Hydrogen has no neutron, because 1, 1. Hydrogen has no neutron. So B is wrong, so we choose option A. 38 is A. Something repels, so it is reflected. And mostly atom is empty space. Question 39. Nuclear fusion is a reaction that takes place in stars. Which row describes the reaction? Fusion, it means the join to make a, not split, but join. So energy is still released in fusion. So this is the explanation for nuclear fission and fusion. So in fusion and fission, both energy is released. Releasing energy. And releasing energy. And fusion is the fusing to form larger nucleus. That is fusion. Well, fission is splitting. The reason we choose question 39, fusion is joint and energy is released. 39 is D. 40, when a radioactive isotope is set up to a counter, a count rate of 38,000 counts per second is obtained. The table shows the count rate from the isotope over 3 years period. What is the half-life of the isotope? So it is 0 is 39. Half of 38,000, I mean, is 19,000. So 38 divided by 2 is 19,000. So it should be between this and this. So it means must be more than 1 year and less than 2 years. So it will be B, question 40. So that's all the last question. We scroll up so we may take a screenshot of the answer if you need to, and if there's any question, please feel free to write in the comment section in Susan Hero YouTube channel. We will explain to you with another video for free. Okay, this is question 1, this is question 2, this is question 3, this is question 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Nine, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33. Checking. Question 33, 34, and then 30. Question 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, and 40. So today we have discussed physics past paper, IGCSE grade 10, paper 2, MCQ, multiple choice. With the past paper code 0625/22 is from past paper February-March 2022. Don't forget to check links in the description. Click this button at the right bottom corner of this video. You'll see all other useful links. Like and share to anybody who might need this, and ring the bell so you will be the first to be notified when we release our latest updates weekly. So today's discussion is conducted by Study with Vision Online. We gather for all the subject and program. Please email us if you're interested to join with us. And don't forget to check link in the description for other useful video. Bye-bye, and we hope today's discussion is useful to you. Bye-bye, and God bless you.